Panspermia, or the idea of life hitching a ride on a meteorite and then seeding another world with microbial life, is an intriguing concept that has a lot of implications. That specific type of panspermia is known as lithopanspermia, life transfer by rock. There are others, such as bacterial spores directly moving around in space. Bacterial spores are dormant and have shown enormous resilience, with examples surviving as long as 6 years exposed to space and dehydration. An even stranger one that's been advanced is plant seeds moving through space. That's much more complicated in that you need a planet to evolve an analog of plants, which is not guaranteed, and then evolve a method of reproduction, like a seed, that is something like our seeds in nature. Enough to be able to survive in space for a time. Even then though, Earth seeds have a shelf life. The oldest known seed that's been germinated successfully was only about 2,000 years old. We don't know what the actual upper limit for that is, but as gardeners will know, seeds do not remain viable forever, with a great many being viable for not much more than a year depending on the plant. But there's a worse problem. The chances of a bacterial spore or a plant seed surviving entry into a planet's atmosphere seem low. It may be possible, but it's also easy to see a tomato seed burning up almost instantly. But a full-on large rock can certainly do it, and make it to the surface. Indeed, many do, retaining absolutely pristine interiors free of contamination from Earth. They could transport life. Still, the hypothesis of panspermia remains controversial in all its forms. Some of the controversy, such as seeds burning up, are valid enough concerns. But some criticism seems reactionary, such as the argument that panspermia just shifts the origin of life question from one planet to another. That's superficial. The phenomenon either happens or it doesn't. Perhaps the strangest argument was that it wasn't testable. Aside from sticking some microbes in a simulation of a rock in space and seeing if they survive, there may be a number of ways to test it independent of experiments on the resilience of organisms on Earth. Further thought has yielded ways panspermia might become evident through astronomical observation, and it comes with implications. One of these implications is that if we could prove that panspermia occurs one way or another, we would then need to ask some very serious questions about just where life on Earth originates, and not make the assumption that it came from here, even if that may seem more likely by virtue of currently being on Earth. But it may be that our brand of life here originated in space, rather than on Earth, and there may be ways to test that too if we ever find other microbial life in the solar system. Early in the solar system's history, it had at least two, probably three, water worlds that might have spawned life: Earth, Mars, and Venus. Two of those became uninhabitable on their surfaces, but that took time. All three of them held conditions for abiogenesis and life, in many ways very similar conditions to each other for millions of years. As a result, life could have arisen on all three independently, or one of them, and then was transferred to the others via panspermia, or some combination of circumstances. Finding other microbial life in the solar system may answer this. If we found microbes at Venus, Mars, or in one of the ice shell moons, then we should be able to determine if it is genetically related to Earth life, or completely alien to it. That's one way to prove panspermia, but it also may shed light on what planet had life first, if it's all related. The geneticists may be able to piece together what was the earlier microbe based on its genome. But there are other ways to prove panspermia, and another plausible one would be finding a fresh meteorite infected with alien life. But we'd have to get lucky for that. This has never happened. No fresh meteorite in our collections contained active life. The closest we've come is via what might be, but has never been proven to be and remains controversial, fossils of life in several of the Martian meteorites. But to be clear, we've never actually seen anything alive in a meteorite that wasn't from Earth. That doesn't mean it can't happen, but it's a terrible way to look, because you have to first recognize that it is life, which is harder than it seems, and you basically have to search a bunch of fresh meteorites for it, which we don't have. And if we did, they would need to be numerous in order to catch one that just happens to have alien microbes in it, more than anyone could hope to search. Proving panspermia that way is a step too far, and falls down to sheer luck if it were to happen. But there is another way to determine if panspermia occurs in the universe. We are right now beginning the process of trying to characterize exoplanet atmospheres and recognize active biospheres on exoplanets. As we do that, it will eventually become clear that either biospheres and life are common in the galaxy or they are not. If we never see a biosphere at all, then that solves the Fermi paradox, because it just means that life is rare, and intelligent life even rarer. As an aside, there's that pesky issue of this star system having harbored, early in its history, three planets with surface liquid water. That tends to suggest that such things are not rare in the universe. Where it gets situational is if those planets, in or near the habitable zone, can maintain their liquid water long term. Even Earth can't do this. As the sun brightens with age, our oceans will boil off. But at the same time, the habitable zone doesn't disappear, it just moves outward. Once we can really search for and characterize terrestrial worlds, we may see that ocean worlds, at least, are very common. Biospheres are another question, however. It's a complete unknown as to whether they are common or rare. But if we start seeing biospheres commonly, either through studying exoplanets or finding evidence of indigenous life on Venus or Mars, but we see no technosignatures, then it deepens the Fermi paradox. But one interesting aspect of this is that once you do have a sampling of biospheres, you can start to look for patterns in the locations of those worlds within the galaxy. If you see a clustering of living worlds, but rarely one-offs, but also areas of the galaxy where there is no life at all, when there should be, then you have an indicator of some type of panspermia and its importance to life in the galaxy. It would be difficult in some cases to differentiate natural phenomena through rocks and aliens seeding other planets with life, technological panspermia. But it is possible, because if you see clustered worlds like this, but you see no technosignatures, then chances are you are seeing a product of natural panspermia. If you see technosignatures, then you're probably seeing alien colonizers exporting the biosphere of their planet, or some mix of the two. And there is a wild card here. Most stars originally formed in star-forming regions, clusters of stars. The Sun did, and there are candidate stars for siblings of the Sun that also originate in the same birth cluster. These stars, however, are now scattered all over the galaxy. That has an interesting effect if panspermia widely occurs. In a birth cluster, early on all of the stars would have been in close proximity to each other, as their planets formed up and life became possible on habitable worlds. Not only do you have the potential for panspermia in each of the star systems, but panspermia between star systems in the cluster. That's an interesting notion, because it brings onto the table the idea that life on Earth didn't originate in the solar system, but some other star in the birth cluster. And it may be that entire birth clusters of stars become infected with life, and that life then spreads across the galaxy as the cluster disperses. Since panspermia never stops, so long as there are impacts and life on a world, then you could end up with a whole galaxy full of life that's related through common microbial ancestry. And this goes for Earth as well. If life on Earth started here, indigenous to Earth, and some of it was blasted off and it infected another member of the birth cluster, it then went on to infect other stars, all while throughout the life of the solar system it has interacted with passing, unrelated stars and their systems, possibly infecting those planets. Then this galaxy is full of not just life, but life that originally came from Earth. I don't know that we would ever see that, but it is possible so far as we know. While proving that would require a whole lot of interstellar space travel and an immense amount of time, I do find it to be a fun idea, because it would mean that Earth would just be one take on what its microbial life could eventually evolve into. All of those other worlds would be completely different in their evolutionary paths, leading to animal life that's a bit like us in some respects, but radically different in form. The profiles of extinct species from past ages of the Earth is interesting enough. This planet and its life looked very different in the past. The idea of a complete, almost blank slate start for Earth life elsewhere is even more interesting. But within all of this, there is an interesting effect. So when and if we see a solid biosignature at an exoplanet, say with the James Webb telescope, the problem is going to be in proving that it is indeed a biosignature. This gets into gas profiles and how they could be made by geology. So if you see a strange mix of gases in disequilibrium that shouldn't be there, that could mean life. But they usually can also mean something else, such as volcanism, or very situational reasons why the exoplanet could have those gases without a biological source. This has led to much thinking and work into trying to find unambiguous biosignatures that can't be anything but life. But that problem lessens by orders of magnitude if you start seeing clustering, where you see a bunch of exoplanets in the same general area of space showing a similar biosignature. It would point to some type of panspermia. And if there isn't any technosignature there, then you have a much more solid case for natural panspermia in those star systems. That thinking also benefits from being agnostic, meaning that it suffers from less of the biases inherent in searching for biosignatures, because we tend to base everything on the type of life we know, our own, having not seen anything else. Who knows, maybe the key to discovering alien life will be in clusters of surface water exoplanets instead of individuals. And maybe that's how our own solar system once was too. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently signing off for September. You know what that means. Spooky season commences, and I'm off to start making the videos. It's going to be fun, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.